Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsip, and I hope you are having a great day. And if you weren't before, I'm sure you will be after you viewed this video on the wonderful world of the cranial osteology you need to know for the mastication session. We're going to have a completely separate video on mandibular osteology, so we will not be discussing the full skull in this video, but there's still a lot of good stuff, so let's get started. And we will start with a review structure, but this is pertinent to this session because it is the foramen that allows the mandibular nerve, or V3, to exit the skull. So, take a moment and try to find the foramen ovale located on the greater wing of the sphenoid on your own. So take a moment, and hopefully you have found your way to locating either this one or this one as the foramen ovale. And it will also be the path by which the lesser petrosal nerve will exit the skull. All right, there's a lot going on this slide, so we're going to take our time to work through these structures. We are looking at an inferior view of the crania, which the photo has been cut off some of this posterior portion, so we can focus more on this region. And this complex right in this region, I'm going to kind of outline. This region right here. This whole region is going to be the pterygoid process, and it's going to include two plates of bone. There's going to be the more lateral plate and the medial plate here, and they're exactly what they would sound like. This one is more medial or laterally placed. This one's more medially placed, and then you can see on this medial plate there is a projection here, and this is the pterygoid hamulus, and a tendon of one of the palate muscles, the tensor veli palatini, will glide along this hamulus. Returning back to this lateral pterygoid plate, it is going to be related to the infratemporal fossa. In fact, it's going to form the medial wall of the infratemporal fossa, and it's also very important in terms of the attachments of the medial and lateral pterygoid muscles. In fact, the relationship of the pterygoid muscles to the lateral plate is where they get their medial and lateral names. So the medial pterygoid muscle will attach on the medial surface, whereas the lateral pterygoid will be on the lateral surface. The medial pterygoid plate is more related with the pharyngeal region, so it's going to be an attachment point for the pterygomandibular raphae and superior pharyngeal constrictor. Alright, moving into this region, you see a little bit of a spine right here-ish, and this is going to be the sphenoid spine, which is certainly on a much smaller scale than those pterygoid plates, and it is going to be over here near the foramen spinosum, which hopefully we're getting more and more familiar with as we move on, as well as the external opening of the carotid canal. So if there's a spine or a projection, this likely means something attaches there, which in this case is the sphenomandibular ligament. All right, returning back to the pterygoid process region, there are going to be two fossae that we want you to know located in between the two plates. The pterygoid fossa is going to be the more inferior of the two. And, you know, notice that this is going to be inferior, or closer to the teeth here. This part that's closer to the base is going to be more superiorly placed. And so this part of the fossa down here is going to be the scaphoid fossa. And so the scaphoid fossa is going to be the origin site for the tensor veli palatini. Last but not least, for this slide, let's locate the pterygoid canal. And this is going to be, if you go back to finding those pterygoid plates and kind of head back posteriorly in between the two plates, it's going to be right around this region here. And sometimes you'll see it kind of, you'll see it labeled some in a little bit more medial placement there. Sometimes you even see it labeled all the way over here, but for our purposes, we are going to label right about in this region the pterygoid canal, or the opening to the pterygoid canal. What's more important, perhaps, than being able to identify that small area right there, is to understand that the nerve of the pterygoid canal, which is heading for the pterygopalatine ganglion, is going to traverse that region. And so that pterygopalatine ganglion is one of the peripheral parasympathetic ganglia. All right, let's move to a lateral view of the cranium. The infratemporal crest, which we have here as part of the sphenoid bone, but it can extend into the temporal bone region, is going to be located right about there where I've just underlined. And this is an attachment site of the temporalis muscle, which makes sense because if you think of the main area that the belly of the temporalis muscle is, it makes sense that you're going to have some form of attachment right there. We're already hopefully quite familiar with the styloid process. This is a very prominent one on this particular donor. And this will be an attachment site for various ligaments associated with the TMJ and then, of course, the muscles. And the maxillary tuberosity is next. And I always go to the very back of the teeth. And, you know, we're on the maxillary bone. And it's going to be this posterior most extent. There's a little bump right in this region. And that's going to be the maxillary tuberosity. The medial pterygoid muscle will have an attachment on this maxillary tuberosity, on this posterior portion of the maxilla. All right, let's focus a little bit on the zygomatic arch. And the zygomatic arch is going to extend from about here-ish to about here-ish. Some people put it right here. Some people go even further back into here. The point is that it's this arch in this region here. And it is going to be composed of the temporal process of the zygomatic bone, which you can see is the shorter process. The zygomatic process of the temporal bone is considerably larger. And you can kind of see where they're separated right here by the suture. The articular tubercle, which I'm going to underline, is this inferior projection of the zygomatic arch, and this forms the anterior limit of the mandibular fossa, which really means an anterior limit of the TMJ. And so what happens a lot of times in anterior dislocations is that the mandibular condyle will actually move anterior to or out of place, so anterior to this articular tubercle. All right, recall that the mandibular fossa is this depressed region right in here. It is going to be the cranial portion of the temporomandibular joint. It is a smooth area, which you can see nicely here on the one I haven't labeled, because articular cartilage really sits in this region during life. And then the petrotympanic fissure is going to be just posterior to the mandibular fossa. And you can see it is very thin. It's usually easiest to locate if you look just posterior to that. And the chorda tympani will exit the skull here. And here's another view of the styloid process. Lastly, let's identify the superior or proximal attachments of the temporalis muscle and fascia. The superior temporal line is, as its name would suggest, the superior one, and it will be the attachment for temporal fascia. Whereas, and so you can see that it's going to extend this fairly long, I didn't mean to make it so curvy back there, a fairly long area. Same thing for the inferior temporal line, right there. And the inferior temporal line will be the attachment site, or the superiormost attachment site for the temporalis muscle and its tendon itself. Sometimes the lines are not very obvious, but they certainly are on this donor. And so you kind of have to just understand the general areas if it's not as robust. All right, so that was a lot of good cranial osteology fun. As you review this material and you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great day.